Hello. Today we will be talking about a topic which is otosclerosis. Otosclerosis is one of the common causes of conductive hearing loss with an intact tympanic membrane. It is one of the major ear problems. It is a condition associated with speech discrimination problems along with conductive hearing loss. So there are three hallmark: conductive hearing loss, intact tympanic membrane, and speech discrimination problems. The main points which we will be discussing are the introduction and definition, the pertinent anatomy related to the condition, the risk factors and the etiology, types of otosclerosis and their pathology, clinical features which includes the symptoms and the signs, investigations and the treatment options. Now first, how there is a process of bone formation and bone resorption occurs. Bone formation occurs by the osteoblast and bone resorption occurs by the osteoclast. Like all other bones in the body, the petrous bone also undergoes these process of maturation and differentiation. But due to some hereditary factors, due to some pathological changes in the petrous bone, the spongy bone is replaced by the sclerotic bone. The lamellar bone is first replaced by the spongy bone, then by the sclerotic bone, which will lead to otosclerosis. Now, which part of the petrous bone is affected? That is the otic capsule. The otic capsule is affected. The otic capsule is the bone of the bony labyrinth of the inner ear. With this, it is the bone which is affected in this disease. The otosclerotic focus consists of, first there is a bone resorption, then there is a new bone formation, then there is a vascular proliferation, and then there is the connective tissue stroma is formed all around the focus. So, otosclerosis is a hereditary and a localized disease of bone derived from the otic capsule, which is characterized by alternating phases of bone resorption and new bone formation. So, first there is a bone resorption, that is normal bone is destroyed, and there is a new bone formation, but this new bone formation is not the normal bone, it is a spongy bone which later is replaced by sclerotic bone. So, lamellar bone is replaced by the spongy bone, and hence due to it there is a conductive hearing loss with intact tympanic membrane. It is disorganized bone remodeling, and it reduces the movements of the stapes footplate in the oval window, because the most common site of predilection for this disease to occur, for the bony changes in the bone to occur, is the region of the oval window and the stapes footplate. Most commonly it is seen on the anterior part of the stapes footplate. This is the anterior crura of the stapes. This is the footplate. This is the posterior crura. This is the incurostapedial joint. So here this is the otosclerotic foci. Now here, due to this foci, there is a decrease in the piston-like movement of the stapes, and hence there will be loss of energy transmission from the middle ear to the inner ear, and hence there will be conductive hearing loss. Here in this figure also, we can see a bone growth due to the otosclerotic foci all around the oval window, and hence this will not allow the normal movement of the stapes. Also, this foci can also have direct effect on the cochlea. If this foci is affecting the bone of the cochlea, it will result in a sensory neural hearing loss. Now, talking about the pertinent anatomy, it is important to know the anatomy of the bony and the membranous labyrinth of the inner ear. The inner ear consists of a bony labyrinth, that is the otic capsule, and inside it is a membranous labyrinth or otic labyrinth or endolymphatic labyrinth. Between these two, the membranous labyrinth and the bony labyrinth, there is a perilymphatic labyrinth or penilymphatic space, or which is also known as the periotic labyrinth. This disease is affecting the bony labyrinth, which has three layers: endoosteal, enchondrial and periosteal. The disease process here is affecting this endochondral layer. This is the endochondral layer, which is the middle layer of the bony labyrinth. This is the periosteal layer. This is the endochondrial layer, which consists of the embryonic cell rest, which are known as the globuli introsi. And this innermost layer is the endoosteal layer. The changes are occurring in these globular enteroci, which add increased vascularity, and then there is a spongiform changes in this layer, which will lead to the formation of otosclerotic foci. Now, the bony labyrinth. This is the figure showing the bony labyrinth, or the bony part, which inside, when the bony part is removed, bony labyrinth is covering this membranous part. So here we can see, this is the blue colored is the membranous labyrinth. Between this bony and this membranous labyrinth, here this is the perilymphatic space, or which contains the perilymph. This membranous labyrinth contains the endolymph. In this figure we can see, this outermost is the bony labyrinth, this inner is the membranous labyrinth. Between the bony and membranous labyrinth, there is perilymph, a fluid which is similar to cerebrospinal fluid. Between this membranous labyrinth, inside this membranous labyrinth, it is filled with the endolymph, which is rich in potassium. All these fluids are important for maintenance of the balance and for the conduction of the sound. Now the pathogenesis of the otosclerosis. So here in this figure you can see, this is the incus bone, this is the stapes bone, and this is the foot plate which is attached to the oval window. Now there is a start of the otosclerotic foci anterior to the in the anterior crus or anterior crura of the stapes. This foci will lead to first to the fixation of the anterior crus of the stapes. Then this foci will be spreading to the other region involving the posterior crus, and then involving the entire foot plate. So now you can understand this sentence, that otosclerosis is a disease of abnormal bone remodeling. That is, there is a pathological change in the bone, and this is occurring in the endochondral layer of the temporal bone. In this layer, in the middle layer, that is the endochondral layer of the temporal bone. In this hard endochondral bone, there are cartilage of the globular enteroci, and due to certain non-specific factors, they are activated to form the new spongy bone. This irregular foci, first there is a formation of the spongy bone in this irregular fashion. So these changes are known as the otospongiosis. Now, then it further undergoes maturation to form the otosclerotic focus. So the otosclerotic focus usually involves the stapes region and results in a stapes fixation and the conductive deafness. There is a portion in front of this oval window which is known as the fistula antefenestrum. This is a site of predilection for the stapedial type of otosclerosis. Also, this otosclerosis or otospongiotic changes can involve any other areas of the bony labyrinth. It is not necessary that it may only involve the stapes or the oval window region. It can involve other areas of the bony labyrinth as well. It can involve the layers of the part of the cochlea as well. So hence it can cause direct sensorineural hearing loss. Now first we will seeing the genetic background. What are the genetic factors? What are the genes which are affected? So OTSC 1 to 8 genes, 1 to 8 genes are affected. BMP, TGF beta 1, COL1 A1 or COL A2. These COL A1 and A2 are the genes for the collagen synthesis. They are affected. Also, there are factors of autoimmunity. So in some patients, there is an autoimmune kind of a reaction. Some theories believe that there is a persistent measles virus infection which leads to these changes in the bone. Also, sex hormones, estrogen and progesterone have been implicated. Some environmental factors, that lack of sodium fluoride in the diet may lead to these changes in the bone remodeling. And inflammatory factors like TNF-alpha, TGF-beta, interleukin 1 and 6, RANK and RANK-L ligand mutations in these inflammatory factors may lead to these changes. Most common is the hereditary. 50% cases have the positive family history. The mode of transmission is autosomal dominant inheritance with incomplete penetrance. So autosomal dominant with incomplete penetrance, it is a heterogenetic, that is more than one gene defect can be there. So 8 loci are identified, that is OTSC 1 to OTSC 8. These loci are there where there will be gene defects. And some cases have been related with the COL1 A1 gene that code for type 1 collagen, which is a predominant collagen of the bone. Viral factors include the persistent measles virus infection, and it is also similar to Paget's disease of the bone, which is due to the defective paramyxovirus. Now, this condition, which is osteogenesis imperfecta, are also associated with many a times with otosclerosis. About 50% of cases of type 1 osteogenesis imperfecta, that is type 1 variant of osteogenesis imperfecta, they develop the hearing loss, histological changes, and that are similar to otosclerosis. They also have, so how to identify a patient of osteogenesis imperfecta? They will have abnormal bones, brittle bones, they will have multiple fractures of the bones, and also a syndrome has been identified which consists of the triad of osteogenesis imperfecta, otosclerosis and blue scala, which is known as the Vanderhoof syndrome. Now coming to the pathology. So on gross appearance, otosclerotic lesions appear chalky white, grayish or yellow. The red color indicates increased vascularity. So red color points out to the active or the progressive focus. So main part is the oval window which is affected. So there will be redness around the region of the oval window. On histological examination, or that is on microscopic examination, there is an abnormal bone remodeling and there is a resorption of the uncontrolled bony labyrinth. So uncontrolled bony labyrinth is replaced with the hypercellular woven spongy bone. So we can see two types of histopathological pictures. One is an immature active lesion, that is the lesions which are still proliferating, which have not matured, which are not come to the last stage. It will be vascular because there will be increased vascularity. It is still maturing, so there will be plenty of histiocytes, osteoblast precursor cells in this. So this, when we stain with the hematoxylin and eosin stain, there is a lot of cement substance which will stain blue, and this is known as the blue mantle, which is the first histological sign in otosclerosis, which is an extracellular staining pattern which is known as the blue mantle. But in mature lesions, those lesions who have already matured, who have come to those have reached the otosclerotic stage, there are less vascular spaces and less, more of bone than the fibrillar substance, which will stain red with hematoxylin and eosin stain. So these are the features pathologically how we can differentiate the mature and the mature lesions. So now talking about the sites of predilection, as we already discussed, that it is not necessary that the otosclerotic foci may only involve the oval window region or the stapes region. It may involve other regions as well, but stapes also in the stapes footplate, anterior part of the footplate is the most common. That is, the 96% of the cases will have focus anterior to the footplate, and in that case there will be hearing loss at low frequencies because this region is associated with the basal coil of the cochlea. And when this focus will proliferate, there will be bony fixation of the stapes because the stapedo-vestibular joint is affected, and then there will be hearing loss at all the frequencies. Now other sites which are affected are the round window niche, that is 30%, cochlear apex 12% of the cases, also walls of the internal auditory canal and around the cochlear duct and the semicircular canals can be affected rarely. So in this figure we can see different sites of otosclerosis. This is the oval window region, this is the semicircular canal, which are concerned with the balance. So if this area is affected, then patients will present with the symptoms of vertigo. If cochlea is affected, there will be sensory neural hearing loss. So now types of the otosclerosis. First we are talking about the stapedial otosclerosis. Stapedial otosclerosis, which is the most common variety. If there is an anterior focus, that is in front of the oval window, which is the most common site of predilection, it can be a, type B is the posterior focus behind the oval window. Type C is a circumferential, that is disease has spread all around the margin of the stapes footplate. Type D is a biscuit type, that is stapes has the otosclerotic foci has involved the entire footplate, but the rim, that is the annular ligament, is free. So that is the biscuit type. And this is the obliterative or the worst type, that is it completely obliterates the oval window niche, and there will be a hearing loss at all the frequencies here. So type A or type B has a mild variety rather than type C, D or E. Now, cochlear otosclerosis. Cochlear otosclerosis is the otosclerosis involving the region of the round window and the areas in the bony labyrinth. It can occur due to the progressive enlargement of the perifenestral foci, that is this foci, which have involved this fenestra, the stapes foot plate, now further progress to the cochlear part of the otic capsule. So, it can occur due to enlargement of that foci, or directly there will be a single or multiple foci in other locations of the cochlear or labyrinthine capsule. Whenever there is a cochlear otosclerosis, it will present with irreversible SNHL. Why this irreversible SNHL is occurring when only the bone is affected? Why SNHL is occurring? Because there are toxic materials which are liberated into the inner ear fluid whenever the bone is affected. Whenever the changes are of the otic capsule bone are going on, there will be toxic material liberated into the inner ear fluid. Now, histologic otosclerosis. Histologic otosclerosis is a type which is diagnosed only on histologic examination, which is a incidental finding because the patients are asymptomatic, they don't have any symptoms. Now, the clinical features. The clinical features are characterized by a gradually progressive conductive hearing loss with normal tympanic membrane. And in most of the cases, this is affecting both the sides, that is both the ears, so it is bilateral. Patients usually are coming in the sclerotic last stage. There is early detection is usually not possible. White races are affected more than blacks. The presenting age is usually 30 to 40 years. And females are more affected than males, and especially the disease is aggravated during pregnancy and menopause. The common symptoms are, there is a pressure, hearing loss is the commonest symptom. Other associated symptom can be pressure or popping or crackling. There may be tinnitus, or patient may feel heaviness in the ear. We may have like water stuck in the ear. So this hearing loss, which is painless, gradually progressive, bilateral, can be due to two reasons. One is the fixation of the stapes foot plate, and hence the mobility of the stapes is decreased, and hence there will be no conduction of the sound from the middle to inner ear. Or that can be due to the senile changes, due to the changes in the cochlea. It can be a conductive or mixed type of the hearing loss. Now, one condition, which is paracasis villi, is associated with otosclerosis. It is a phenomena where the patient hearing is improving in the noisy background. So why this is occurring? Because in the noisy background, a normal person will speak louder than normal. So louder, when a person is speaking louder, the patient is able to hear better. So in noisy background, there is a patient improvement in the patient's hearing. And speech discrimination is not affected in the early stages that of pure conductive hearing loss. Tinnitus is a symptom which is more in a cochlear otosclerosis and in active lesions. Vertigo or the vestibular symptoms, it can be present if there are hypertension or metabolic disorders associated along with the otosclerosis, or if the otosclerotic foci is involving the semicircular canals. The speech of the patient will be low, monotonous, well-modulated soft speech, but the patient will not be able to hear low speech of the other person with whom he or she is conversing. Now, signs. On otoscopy, the tympanic membrane is absolutely normal and mobile, but whenever there is an active or spongiotic lesions of which have a rich hypervascularity and hyperemic mucosa, so we can see a red blush through the normal tympanic membrane on the promontory, which is named after Hermann Schwarz. So it is known as a Schwarz sign. And in tuning fork tests, which are the primary and the most reliable test to assess any of the ear conditions, especially if conductive hearing loss. So Rinne's test is usually negative with 512 and 1024 Hz in otosclerosis. Now, investigations. So investigations, the most important investigations are audiological tests, and in that there is a pure tone audiometry. In pure tone audiometry, there is a conductive hearing loss more at the lower frequencies than the higher frequencies. This is a pure tone audiogram. Here, this is the hearing level, and these are the frequency in hertz. So these are the lower frequencies and the higher frequency. You can see there is a conductive hearing loss more towards the lower frequencies than the higher. One notch is seen at bone conduction at 2000 kilohertz or 2000 hertz. So this notch seen at the bone conduction in 2000 hertz is known as the Cahart's notch. It disappears after if the successful surgery, that is tepidectomy surgery, is done. So this notch is known as the Cahart's notch. Maximal hearing loss, which is seen in this Puritan audiogram from Stapes fixation, is usually 55 to 60 dB. 55 to 60 dB is the hearing loss seen maximal in the Stapes fixation due to otosclerosis. There will be airborne gap. So we have to see this loss of air conduction more at the lower frequencies, Cahart's notch in the bone conduction, and the airborne gap. So this degree of the airborne gap, how much airborne gap is there, is estimated by the degree of foot plate fixation. More the foot plate fixation, more the airborne gap. But it does not predict the pattern or extent of the oval window involvement. How much oval window part is involved, we don't know from the Puritan audiogram. We can only see when we are opening the middle ear, when we are doing the exploratory tympanotomy. Also, there may be here the bone conduction is normal, but it can also be decreased if there is a sensorineural hearing loss. So there can be mixed hearing loss, that is bone and air conduction both can be decreased. That picture can also be seen in Puritan audiogram. Impedance audiometry. In impedance audiometry, there is a AS type of curve, that is the compliance of the tympanic membrane is decreased than normal. This is the normal tympanometry curve. Here, this is the AS type of the curve. The compliance of the middle ear conductive system is less than normal because of the decreased mobility of the ossicular chain. Now, about coming to the differential diagnosis. Differential diagnosis includes the other causes of the conductive hearing loss, especially if the tympanic membrane is intact. So, serous otitis media, adhesive otitis media, tympanosclerosis, fixation of the head of the malleus in the attic, ossicular discontinuity, congenital Stapes fixation, third mobile window, or the superior semicircular dehiscence syndrome. All these are the differential we have to keep in mind when we are thinking about otosclerosis. These all conditions can be ruled out with the help of otoscopy, microscopic or endoscopic examination, tuning fork test, signalization, and some in audiological investigations, impedance, Puritan audiometry, and HRCT temporal bone radiological investigations also help to differentiate this diagnosis. Like in serous otitis media, adhesive otitis media, tympanosclerosis, the tympanic membrane may not seem to be normal. There is a tympanosclerotic patch, or it may be retracted to the promontory. In ossicular discontinuity, the hearing loss is usually more than 60 dB. And in third mobile window, superior semicircular dehiscence syndrome, there is the similar low frequency conductive hearing loss, but the fistula test may be positive. So all these things help to differentiate the conditions. Now, role of the HRCT temporal bone. This is an emerging imaging modality in otosclerosis. Usually the otosclerosis is a clinical diagnosis. There is no need of the imaging study in the diagnosis of otosclerosis. But how it is helping us in the how it is helping us when we are planning for the surgery for the otosclerosis, or when we are wanting to rule out other conditions. So it helps to determine the exact site of the otosclerotic foci. It helps to exclude the presence of other pathologies causing conductive hearing loss. Usually when there is a stapedial otosclerosis, there is a loss of definition of the margin of the oval window seen in the HRCT temporal bone, or there is narrowing or complete obliteration of the oval window opening and the niche. HRCT temporal bone is also important to evaluate the post-surgical cases in which there is an initial improvement in hearing, but after a few days this hearing improvement is lost, or patient is having a post-epidectomy vertigo. So we have to see when we have placed a prosthesis, artificial prosthesis, in place of the stapes, we have to look at its position. There is HRCT temporal bone is helping us in that. So we can see if there is a protrusion of the prosthesis into the vestibule, if there is a separation of the lateral end or dislocation of the medial end of the prosthesis, or there is a recurrence of the disease, there is a reobliteration of the oval window region due to a recurrent otosclerotic disease. All these can be ruled out on HRCT temporal bone. Also, we can easily see the cochlear otosclerosis, the ossifications. This is a normal cochlea. Here there is a rim of ossified bone around the cochlea, which is sometimes known as a double ring effect in cochlear otosclerosis. Now coming to the treatment. So there is no curative treatment as such, but the treatment of choice is a surgical, that is stapedectomy or stapedotomy. We remove the part of the stapes. This is the oval window. This is the incus. Here there is a stapes, which stapes whose footplate is fixed. So either we remove the entire footplate or a part of the footplate which is involved in otosclerosis, and in place of that we are placing different type, any kind of processes which will do the work of the stapes, which will do the work of the piston and conduct the sound to from the incus, to conduct vibration from the incus to the oval window. Other helpful modalities of the treatment: whenever surgery is contraindicated or whenever the patient does not want to go for the surgery, we can give a supportive treatment in form of hearing aid or sodium fluoride therapy. Now, sodium fluoride acts to hasten the maturity of the active focus and arrest the further SNHL. Now, when we are talking about stapedectomy, so it consists of the removal of the fixed stapes and insertion of the processes between the incus and the oval window. These processes are of different materials like Teflon, stainless steel, TEF wire, fat wire processes. Any kind of the processes, depending upon the choice of the surgeon and the patient, can be used. Another procedure which is not done much but is of academic value is a stapes mobilization. So there is a 1% of the otosclerotic ear have fibrous fixation of the stapes. This stapes is, there is only a fibrous band or fibrous foci that is fixing the stapes, any one crust or the part of the footplate of the stapes. So we are removing, we are separating that part from the other fibrous foci and that mobilizing the stapes, but it is not indicated because it leads to refixation. Whenever we have mobilized the stapes, it can easily refix it due to the growth of the foci. Another thing is the fenestration operation, which has almost been abandoned now. It consists of the creation of the alternate window in the lateral semicircular canal, but it has a disadvantage of the postoperative mastoid cavity, and that cavity itself is giving the inherent hearing loss of 25 decibels. Because to create a fenestra in the lateral semicircular canal, we have to open the mastoid, we have to go through the mastoid into the middle ear or medial wall of the middle ear where LSC, lateral semicircular canal, is situated. Hearing aids are offer a good results in patients who are unfit for surgery or refuse for surgery. Now about the procedure, about the surgery, which is stapedectomy or stapedotomy. The main aim or main thing which we are doing is the removal of the otosclerotic foci. That is the necessary, and we have to replace the part which we have removed with the prosthesis. So when we will be going for surgery, what are the points which we will be keeping in mind when we are posting a patient for surgery. The patient should have a minimum airborne gap of 25 decibel in speech frequencies, that is 250 hertz to 1 kilohertz. Whenever we are thinking of the surgery, there should be a negative Rinne's test at 512 hertz tuning fork, and the speech discrimination score should be good, that is 60% or more. If there is a bilateral involvement, if both the ears are involved, then the worst hearing ear is operated first. If there is a mixed hearing loss, if the patient is having a mixed hearing loss, then if the speech discrimination is good, then also we can go for surgery. But we have to explain the patient that for the sensory neural component, the patient will have to wear a hearing aid because there is no way to improve the sensory neural hearing loss. So here we can see we have removed the stapes footplate and the stapes we have removed. The oval window is exposed, the otosclerotic foci has been removed, and we are replacing it with a prosthesis. This is the basic thing which is done in the stapes surgery. What are the contraindications for the surgery? If there are it is the only hearing ear, we usually do not operate because there are chances of developing a dead ear. If there is a patient is having vestibular symptoms or vertigo, it can be associated with Meniere's disease. So it has to be ruled out before going for surgery. In young children with recurrent Usachian tube dysfunction, there can be acute otitis media which can displace the prosthesis. Also, there are certain occupations or professions that, like athletes, high construction workers, divers, frequent flyers, all these occupations there is changes of high air pressure in the middle ear, which can lead to dislocation or removal of the processes, accidental removal of the processes. So it is not recommended to do this procedure in such persons doing such occupations. Also, in industrial workers who are working in noisy surroundings are more vulnerable to occupational sensorineural hearing loss. So there may not be much improvement in the hearing loss after surgery in such workers. Whenever there is a local disease or any kind of middle ear or external ear infection, then we cannot do surgery, like otitis externa, tympanic membrane perforation. All these have to be treated first before undertaking surgery. Also, stapedectomy is avoided in pregnancy. So now, what is this stapedectomy or stapedotomy? Stapedotomy is the procedure in which we are removing only the otosclerotic foci and creating a hole in the stapedicular and placing the prosthesis in place of that. And stapedectomy includes removal of the entire oval entire stapes footplate and exposing the entire oval window, obliterating the part of the oval window and placing a prosthesis, and the surrounding part of the oval window is obliterated. In this surgery, it is usually done under local anesthesia, because at the end of the surgery, whenever we place the prosthesis, we can check the hearing improvement by doing a Weber's test. So if the if the Weber's is lateralized to the opposite ear, then maybe we can come to a conclusion that there is an improvement in hearing in the operated ear. Right? So first of all, what we are doing after exposing the middle ear cavity by the tympanometal flap, we are exposing this part of the stapes footplate. We are separating this stapes from the incus, and we are cutting the stapedius tendon. We are cutting the anterior and the posterior crura. We are exposing the stapes footplate. Then we are measuring the distance between the stapes footplate and the incus with a measuring rod. Then after we measure the distance, now we can go for the placement of the prosthesis by keeping the prosthesis of the measured distance. We have to keep the prosthesis of that distance what we have measured. For keeping the prosthesis, we have to make a hole in the footplate. This can be done with the help of an electro drill or can be done with the help of a laser. Many kinds of the piston or prosthesis are available. We can choose any. The latest is the smart kind of the piston prosthesis. After placing the prosthesis in the footplate area, there is this crimp-like structure which has to be attached to the narrowest part of the incus. We have to crimp this structure to the incus. This has to be fixed to the incus. If this is not properly fixed to the incus, then it may be dislodged or dislocated or extrude out. So we have to keep this in mind. Then the area around the prosthesis is packed with the gel foam so that the prosthesis doesn't dislodge from its site. And then the flap is repositioned and the middle ear is, the tympanic cavity is closed. So this is the basic steps which we are doing in the stapedotomy surgery. But what is stapedectomy? Stapedectomy involves the removal of the entire footplate. So when it is done, when we need to remove the entire footplate, that is when the footplate is floating, or when it has been accidentally removed, or when we are doing a revision case, that is previously also the patient has been operated for stapedotomy and again there is a recurrence of the disease, we may have to go for stapedectomy then. So energy transfer in stapedectomy is better because there is a better compressional bone conduction, but in stapedotomy at 4 kilohertz there are better results. Specifically in stapedectomy, there can be overstimulation of the sensory apparatus of the inner ear because the entire area of the footplate has been removed, so more energy may be transmitted. So excess energy to the cochlea may cause hair cell damage, but in stapedotomy there is no such thing because only we have created a small hole in the footplate, so there is less damage to the receptors. Also, in the technique of the stapedectomy, there is a risk of damage to the inner ear while placing the prosthesis, while packing it, which is not there in stapedotomy. Also, in stapedectomy, if proper packing is not done, there may be a chance of prosthesis migration. And complications are more instepidectomy than stepidotomy. So more we should go for stepidotomy first. If not possible, then only we should do stepidectomy. Now complications, what can occur after surgery. So there are 2% chances of patients developing sensory neural hearing loss or a dead ear due to the overstimulation of the inner ear or due to the damage to the inner ear structures. Also, patients can develop giddiness or vertigo due to the overstimulation of the vestibular system. Also, there may be loss or distortion of the taste sensation due to the cutting of the caudal tympani nerve, which is passing through the posterior part, behind the medial part of the tympanic membrane. So while elevation of the tympanic membrane, if the caudal tympani nerve is cut, there is a loss or distortion of the taste sensation. If the tympanic membrane is injured while elevating or exposing the middle ear, there can be perforation of the tympanic membrane. If the facial nerve is exposed in the middle ear cavity, it's devoid of its bony covering, then it can also be injured and cause facial nerve paresis or palsy. If there is a drill when we are doing stepidotomy, if the drill is touching any other area other than the foot plate, any other part of the medial wall of the middle ear, then the perilymph may be exposed and the perilymphatic fistula can occur. So all these complications have to be kept in mind. Now we are going for some multiple choice questions which you have to solve by yourself, and the answers will be given later. So thank you. Keep listening to our other lectures as well.